Everybody can hear me clearly? Okay, great. So as he talked about, that I would be talking about infrastructure as a code. Primarily, it is I'll be talking about how you can use how you can implement infrastructure as a code using Terraform. So agenda. So it's a very impromptu PPT that I did. I got to know about this session 2 days back, so I prepared it accordingly. First, I thought that I will probably talk technical, but then I thought that probably it will make a lot more sense if I talk about journey and two aspects of that journey. So the one aspect would be that how we reached to Terraform, where we said that we should use Terraform. This session is about journey of Terraform within OpsTree, how we started using Terraform, and how we matured using Terraform. And as there's a famous quote, a journey of 1,000 miles begins with a single step, and that's how we basically reach to a state where we can say that now we are proficient in Terraform, and for almost 100% of our requirement, we use Terraform. Where it is not applicable, it is not applicable, but at rest of the places, we use Terraform. So I'll start with the first aspect, which is journey to Terraform, that how we matured to Terraform, and it is almost closely related the way OpsTree has been set up. So we started in 2014. We had our first client, and in 2014, the scale of infrastructure was not that complex. We were also a small organization, so obviously a big company was not. So it's not like that we got a big client. We've got a very small client, right? Almost 30 different servers. Though at that point of time, cloud was prominent, but it was static in that sense. So when I say that static, what I mean is that so once you set up your infrastructure, you don't have to play with it a lot, right? So for example, today we talk about that you have a dynamic infrastructure, you spin up your infrastructure, you talk about immutable infrastructure, you say that if you are doing a release, you will spin up your complete environment, right? You do blue, green or other sort of deployment. But at that point of time, it was more like a static infrastructure. You set it up once and then you keep on just maintaining it, right? So you just simply do the deployment on your server, and you set up your infrastructure once, right? And at that point of time, since we were also very new to AWS, so we started with the basic, bare minimum way of managing AWS, that is via AWS Management Console. So what we did, we went to AWS Management Console, did what all we have to do, we created VPCs, subnets, and all those stuff as per our knowledge, and then had that infrastructure up and running, and things were working perfectly fine, right? But as time progressed, we gained more confidence, we gained more knowledge, and in addition to that, few more clients. We got few more clients, right? Now the scale has started increasing. So when I say scale, it was not a very good scale, but yes, now we have few clients. Infrastructure still remained a lot of static in that sense, right? So it was more like that. You will have your infrastructure in place. So your base infrastructure will get created. You will have servers and all those stuff. But still, some sort of dynamism came into the picture, which means that now client used to ask us that, okay, can you increase the capacity of the server? Can you decrease the capacity of the server? Take a snapshot, maybe create an AMI where we use Packer. So all those sort of requirement came. Now obviously, we were doing it manually, right? And we could have continued doing it manually. But with the increasing number of client and increasing number of the scale of infrastructure, we have to find some solution that will help us to scale further. And at that point of time, we figured out, okay, we were using Jenkins from very beginning, because we were using Jenkins for our automation purposes. Though people say that Jenkins is a CI server, I have a very different thought. I treat it as an automation server where you can perform all sort of automation, and having that philosophy in mind, or basically having that context in mind, we said that, okay, let's use Jenkins for our cloud automation aspects as well. So which means that creating of servers, destroying them, increasing their capacity, decreasing their capacity, creating an AMI, all those stuff, right? So initially we started with AWS CLI, we started using AWS CLI. after playing with it some time, having its own limitation, then we figured it out that, okay, we have a SDK as well, which is Boto. So we started using Boto. And again, things became smooth for us, and things were working fine, right? But again, we hit another hurdle. Now this the concept of dynamic infra started coming into picture, right? Where people used to say that, okay, now you should have a dynamic infra. And having a dynamic, one of the thing that you have to have in case of a dynamic infra is that you should have your infrastructure in the form of code, right? Because it serves multiple purposes for you. The one thing is that you keep track of how your infrastructure has evolved, right? You can categorize it in a proper fashion. You can have reusability, maybe by copying, pasting, right? And since we were using, at that point of time, we were using AWS a lot. In fact, I'll say for 100% of our client, we were using AWS. So we started exploring that what all services we have in AWS for infrastructure as a code. So cloud formation was a natural fit for us. And we started using it. And again, it solved our problem. And things were working fine. But what happened that over the period of time, we gained more client, right? And then we hit a scale. Now, the problem that we started facing is that, and I think in your organization as well, you would be facing, and I will be talking about it, that when you hit a scale, right, you face a problem of standardization, right? Every person will try to implement things its own way. Now, to basically overcome that problem, what you do? You say that, okay, let's create something reusable or standardized, right? And so that people can reuse that generic or reusable stuff, so that you will make sure that across all your projects, across all your team members, you have that standardization, you have that standard way of implementation, the way people would be creating their infrastructure, maintaining and managing that, because you want to control that. Though it basically takes that innovation from people, but obviously you would like to have innovation at this particular place so that this can scale faster. So with cloud formation, we sort of hit a bottleneck there, and there was some complexity at that point of time. It was almost 2 years back we stopped using cloud formation. I'm not sure that how much it has evolved over the period of time, but yes, we hit a bottleneck at that point of time. And by the way, how many of you guys, I think most of you guys would be aware about HashiCorp, right? Is there anybody in the room who is not aware about? No, who is not aware about HashiCorp? Okay, so let's say if you are interested in DevOps, I think this is the first company that you should start following. They have awesome products in terms of DevOps tooling. And HashiCorp comes in the topmost list of the companies which I follow. I keep following HashiCorp. So they introduced a tool called Terraform, right? And by this time, other clouds are also started coming into our picture. We have started providing services for Azure, GCP as well, right? So obviously, we have to move away from cloud formation. Now, the point is that probably we could have gone to the cloud native infrastructure as a code, but it made a lot of sense, especially for a DevOps company, right? So let's say, for example, if we would have been a product-based company where we would have only one stack, probably we would have stick with cloud formation. But as we have to support multiple cloud, so Terraform became a obvious choice for us. Reusability, learning curve, feature set are other important aspects. The why we choose Terraform. Now, though I talked about why Terraform, but these are the, I'll say, top 6 points I think, in my opinion, are important. Why we choose Terraform as an obvious choice for infrastructure as a code for OpsTree Solutions. So we said that, and probably I would like to have this session more interactive. So let's say when you say that you want to have infrastructure as a code, obviously you want to maintain infrastructure as a code. So what advantages does a version control system brings into the system? Probably I would like to hear out from you guys only.
I have pushed something to the production and things are not working the way I'd expected it to work. So I can always revert back to the previous
one. Right, great. So one is that you have versions, so which means that you can move forward, you can work in parallel as well, right? So these are the, and one of the important thing is that, and that I have experienced over the period of time. Let's say if you are not having your code in the form of infrastructure, you have to create a lot of documentation, right? But as soon as you go into the form of code, your code becomes the complete documentation and you can have a complete visual representation of your infrastructure, right? And in case of any, yes, please.
Yeah, so I have a question over here. I am using a similar service, serverless framework. It's I think a alternate service of Terraform.
Okay. Right?
So wherein any addition to the infrastructure like Lambda function.
But yeah. I can hear you clearly.
Yeah. So like a Lambda function or any other addition to the infrastructure, we need to completely redeploy everything, right? We need to redeploy the complete infrastructure. It will create new versions.
Yeah, so when I'll talk about our journey of Terraform, I will actually touch base upon this point.
Okay, that is the problem that we are facing.
I will talk about that.
Yeah.
I have that in my PPT.
Okay, great.
So let's wait for some time, right?
Right, yeah.
But let's say if I don't answer, if you feel that I have not answered your question, you can ask that question just before ending this session. But I am assuming that I will be able to answer your question while one of the slide. Yes, so now quality. So this is pretty obvious, right? So we said that reusability. So once you create a reusable component, which means that will, I'll not say that from very first instance, you will have a very quality-driven code, right? But let's say when you have created something reusable and 10, 15, 20 different projects will start using it, over the period of time, it will become very mature in that sense, right? And obviously, you can say that from very beginning, we will want to achieve the quality, but ultimately, if you follow this principle of reusability, you will ultimately reach to quality. Whether you start or not, but ultimately you will reach to quality. Efficiency. So I think that is pretty clear by in itself that once you have reusable stuff in place, it's not like that. Every time when you have to work on the infrastructure of a new client, you have to create things from very go. By the way, anybody heard the term called convention over configuration? Can somebody explain what is convention over configuration?
So instead of everyone defining in this folder, we should have this, in this, we should define this, variable names, et cetera, the framework itself will just say that, okay, do this, put things here, put this thing here. That is...
Perfect, right? Now, if you imagine about your cloud setup, right? You can apply same principle there as well, where you can say that I will prefer a convention over the way you will define everything. So think about probably when we will go further, you will understand it. But what I'm saying that you will say that this is the exact way I would like to set up my cloud infrastructure. How highly available it would be, how services will be deployed publicly or privately, you will define a convention. Once you define a convention, it can apply it across all those projects and you have one single convention which will be followed all across all the projects. So then you don't have to reinvent the wheel. For every project, you will be implementing it. So when we will start our Terraform journey, there you will actually see the advantage and how we evolved it over the period of time as well, right? Yep.
So if it is a normal code, we have some different quality metrics. So when it is infrastructure code, what are the quality metrics?
See, frankly speaking, there are some linters that you can use, right? So for example, in case of Terraform, the way you write a Terraform, there are some quality standards which you should follow. So just to give you an example, and then there are linters available for that. And you can include in your pipeline where you can say that it will perform all those operations.
Right, linters is one aspect of the quality. At the same time, are there any automated static analysis or something that we can do to say, either, because when it comes to linters, right, there are lot of debates.
I totally agree with you. See, we have, so couple of IDs comes with those automated linter, which basically checks and verify your code as per Terraform code standard that you should actually follow that. So for example, one of the mistakes people typically do that when you use variables in Terraform, sometimes you basically keep that particular field empty, right? And there is a linter which basically checks for those things, and it actually throws an error saying that. So though we have not inculcated into this into our pipeline, deployment pipeline, but I'm assuming that there should be some automated quality check analyzer in place, which you can include in your pipeline that will actually verify stuff for you.
Sure.
Right. I think since most of you guys are here, right, so probably you know that we wanted to talk about Terraform. So the community that have developed over the period of time for Terraform and the kind of support that you will get for Terraform, that is exceptional. Right? Can somebody tell what this pick represents? The second last pick? Yeah. This is about vendor lock-in, right? So though this topic is very debatable, right? So some people who support Terraform, they say that Terraform basically moves you away from vendor lock-in, right? But then the counter argument that people says that it's not like that. So let's say if you are using Terraform for AWS, and let's say you decide to use Terraform for GCP or Azure, it's not like that. You can have a same code. You have to have understanding of GCP. You have to have understanding of Azure, and then the language or the kind of resources that you define in Terraform for GCP or AWS, they are altogether different. So this is an argument and counter argument. Well, my take on this particular argument is that let's say we are a DevOps company, right? I'll probably talk from that perspective. Now, if I have to build capability for infrastructure as a code for my team, for me, still Terraform would be an ideal choice for me, because at least from a base construct knowledge wise, that how Terraform works, the flow of Terraform, the integration it provides, it makes a lot of sense. Instead of investing in three different native infrastructure as a code and going with that. So I typically give this particular argument in support of Terraform. In that way, you are actually, you are not locked into a specific vendor. And I have seen, in fact, I was having a discussion with one of my friends, though we have not implemented it in ourselves. So the requirement that they have, that they wanted to have a hybrid cloud. So they wanted to have AWS and GCP, right? They want to maintain and manage that. So for them as well, Terraform made a lot of sense for them, because then one single concept, so I'll say that conceptually they were using one single concept, and using that particular concept, they were managing their AWS infrastructure as well and the GCP infrastructure as well. Standardization, I already talked, right? So one of the principal, at least I recommend to a lot of people, that you should have a standardized way of working things, so that there shouldn't be no silos in company, and you define a standard and then people start following it, so that you will always make sure that you have a certain level of quality and predictability, and then obviously you can move your resources from one place to another place as well. Okay. This is one of my favorite concept, idempotency. It has a lot of value, especially in terms of DevOps. Though it is already explained, but if somebody would like to explain it in their own language, that would be really great. I'm assuming that everybody should be knowing about idempotency. So would somebody like to explain, what do you understand in your own term, not in bookish language or a theoretical way?
Maintaining a state, if you have already something in place, you don't need to recreate it from scratch. It's already there, so no need to touch it.
Right. And then you see in terms of DevOps, it has a lot of significance, right? So for example, when I talk about SCM tools, there also we talk about having reaching to a specific state in terms of our softwares, right? Similarly, if I talk about my cloud infrastructure, there also I want to say that this is the final target state that I want to reach, and this is one of the concept which Terraform also uses behind the scene, where it says that you define a state in my own language, I will compare what is the current state, And then on the basis of that, I will find the delta. And then I'll apply those delta so that the desired state that you want to have your infrastructure to be in, I will make sure that your infrastructure will reach out to that particular state. Okay, so this is an imaginary infrastructure that I am, and again, now let's talk about that standardization, right? Where I talked about convention over configuration. So over the period of time, the experience that we have gained in AWS, what we have identified that though people create their infrastructure for different client in different way, but there's a standard way, at least the base infrastructure that you should create for your AWS infrastructure should be a standard, right? So let's say you have to, a new client, right? And you have to set up the infrastructure for that particular client. So what you will say that there are two or three different strategies in which people implement. So some people say that I would like to have one single VPC and I would like to manage everything. And basically the segregation that they would like to do is via subnet. Some people say that, okay, no, probably I would like to have separate VPC. So they say that probably for every environment, I would like to have a VPC, dev environment, QA, UAT, production, and a management VPC, right? Some people say that I would like to have a prod account, separate prod account. Prod will be set up in that particular, in prod account, we will have a prod VPC, and then we will have a non-prod account. And under one single VPC, we will have all those environments segregated by subnetworks, and then we will have a management VPC. So these are the different strategies. But if you look at the VPC level, the way you will design VPC, it should, in my opinion, it is a pretty standard way in which you will implement a VPC, right? So you will say that, okay, I have a VPC, which will probably, I would like to have a highly available, which means that you would have two availability zones, right? Now, there would be some services which you would like to expose publicly. So obviously, in those two availability zones, you will have two public subnets, right? Then there would be some internal services that you would like to expose. So you will say that probably I will have a private subnet, two private subnet. Now, definitely with the services which you want to expose publicly, obviously you don't want to expose them directly. So what you will have Elastic Load Balancer or an Application Load Balancer. So we'll say that in public subnet, I will only have Application Load Balancer spanned across those two public subnet. In my private subnet, I will have an Application Load Balancer that will span across the two private subnet, and then probably a Bastion server or a VPN server in my public subnet. So this is a typical VPC that you will definitely create. Doesn't matter that which client you have, which strategy you want to have, right? So now we are saying that if this is a typical VPC setup that you want to do, so this is a convention, then you can say that, okay, this is a convention. And if I can have this in the form of code, I will simply say that, okay, create, this is my code, and you will call your, so let's say this is a Terraform code that does this complete thing for you, and then you will ask Terraform that, okay, spin up this for me. Now I will talk about the exact gradual journey that we made using Terraform, right? So how we started it? So we said that, okay, it's pretty simple, right? There's a concept of resources, providers, and backend, and all those stuff. So what we did, we started writing a Terraform file. So let's say for this particular infrastructure, whatever codification that we have to do to create this infrastructure, we created it, right? But once we did it, we had these all problems. So I will talk about it: state, consistency, tracking, manageability, reusability, environmental discrepancy, and isolation. So I will talk about all those points. So first I will talk about three points. One is state, consistency, and tracking. So can somebody tell me what do you understand by state, especially in terms of Terraform?
Terms of cloud, it would mean that I maintain a state of my setup in cloud on my Terraform state table.
Right. So what happens that, see, we said that using Terraform is basically implements idempotency, right? And it identifies that what is the current state and what is the previous state and what is the delta, and on the basis of that delta, it basically implements all those stuff, right? So now the problem with, so when we started using Terraform, what we did, we started implementing Terraform over a single machine, right? Now, when we asked Terraform to basically execute this piece of code, what it did, it generated a state file. But that state file was local on my machine. Now, let's say if my fellow developer, if that person wants to basically work on this infrastructure, what we have to do? We have to pass on this state to that particular person, right? Now, the second problem is consistency. So what happened that, let's say there are two people who are working on the same infrastructure provisioning, right? Now, there may be a chance, since these are two different systems, the version of Terraform may vary between the machines of those two people. Now, as soon as you have something like this, you will struck with this consistency problem, where probably on your machine, it would be working fine. On your fellow developer, it will not work fine, right? Tracking. So when we are saying that everything is getting managed locally, so obviously you cannot track it. People are basically anybody in your team from his or her local machine can run Terraform and ask Terraform to update your infrastructure according the code that you have written. And then you will lose the information that who did what, right? So then we solved these problem by three things, right? So the first thing is we said that, okay, let's make sure that we will not be having, obviously people will develop code on their local machines, but they will never ever run that Terraform code via their local machines. It will always be run via Jenkins, right? And that code will be available in version control system. It can be any version control system that you like, right? And obviously, there you can have code quality check and all those stuff which Ganesh asked. Now, the state problem, so Terraform has a concept of backend, right? And it has a multiple backend, right? So initially what we did, we started, so the previous problem that I talked about, to solve that problem, what we used to do, we used to commit the Terraform state in our version control system as well. So along with code, Terraform state also used to get committed so that if somebody else will run the Terraform code, that person will also get the state. But there we had that problem. Let's say if there is two people simultaneously working on it or doing some stuff, the state may get corrupted, right? So then we said that let's use the concept of backend of Terraform, where you can, it provides a storage. You can have different storage. So what we did, we said that we will use S3 as a backend, where after every execution, the state will be stored, and when you next time run, the state will be retrieved from S3 bucket and compared with the existing state of your infrastructure, and on the basis of that, whatever delta it will figure it out, it will perform those operations for you, right? So far, so well, but still, the infrastructure that I have shown to you, that's a very small infrastructure, right? But typically, it's not like the case, right? You will have hundreds of server. There would be tens of different applications that you want to manage. You want to set up on your cloud, the infrastructure that you want to set up. So obviously, if you have everything in one single file, it will be very difficult to manage. And as you pointed out, you will have that challenge that, okay, I have changed something and everything is getting impacted, right? So to solve that problem, what do? You say that, one of the pattern that people follow is that, let's say I have component 1, component 2, component 3, component 4. Instead of having one single Terraform code, let's create a Terraform code that will only manage component 1, another Terraform code that will only manage component 2, component 3, and component 4. Right? Once you have that, now your Jenkins will be, there will be separate executions for this component 1, separate execution of component 2. So which means that, now, if you only want to do the changes for your component 1, you will only run the job that is associated with execution of this particular code. If you want to run, perform this updation, you will obviously run the code for this. And that's how you can have a localized or isolated execution for your component. Now, the next challenge was, so though we said that we have a reusability, right? But let's assume that we have to create EC2 instances across all those factors, right? Now the point is that, again, there is another convention that we followed, that one of the pattern that we figured it out, that what the mistake that people do, they create EC2 instances and then they use IP2 for the communication. So we said that another convention that we will follow, that any time, at any point of time, if we create an EC2 instance, there will be definitely a domain name, an internal domain name associated with it. So we said that probably the existing resource that Terraform provides, which only creates an EC2 instance for you. We said that no. What we want to do, whenever we will create an EC2 instance, there will be a domain name associated with it, and that would be the name tag that you will provide to your instance, so that you will be aware that, okay, I will be always, if I have to access this particular server, I will be accessing it with that particular domain name, right? So one way is that you create an EC2 instance, you would put an entry of root 53 domain name as well, right? Or you can say that this is a reusable piece of code, which can be reused here, 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 right? So then there's a concept in Terraform, which is called modules, right? So the previous example of VPC that I gave, right? So we said that we have created a VPC module. Now you can use this VPC module for your component, and what will happen? It will create a VPC for you. That VPC will have an internet gateway associated with it. It will have internal domain name, internal root table associated with it. It will have a public root table, private root table, two public subnets, two private subnets, a bastion server, everything. Just by calling this particular module, everything will get created for you. Similarly, if I talk about subnet, so we'll say that I want to have a subnet, probably EC2, right? Here you will say that I want to have an EC2. Similarly for security group, typically some of the standard security group you would like to have, right? So you will say that I want to have a web security group, SSH security group, maybe my Mongo security group, right? So these are the predefined security group that you want to have. So you can create a grouping on the basis of that as well. And then instead of writing all those pieces of code, you will simply say that I want this, this, and this. And I'm pretty much done. Now, I think most of you will agree that the concept of, why do we have a concept of environments? Why can't we have only production environment in place? Huh? Yes, you want to trust your code, right? So you have a dev environment. So dev team will say that, okay, my piece of code is working fine on dev environment. Then you will test your code on QA environment. QA team will test. Then your business team will test it on UAT. Performance test team will test it in performance test environment. But one thing that you want to have is that they should be a replica of your production environment, maybe a toned down replica, right? But you want them to be a replica of your environment, right? Now when you are saying that you want to manage your infrastructure using code, which means that you can have a reusability there as well, where you will say that, let me create a module for my application setup. So this is my component. This is my, when I run this, it will do this thing. But I will pass other information that how many servers I want to have, right? In which subnet I want to launch it. So once you have that, so your environmental discrepancies goes away, because you have a common code which is setting up your environment. The only thing is you're saying that I want it for dev environment, QA, UAT, and prod, and you're just passing those corresponding variables to it. So then what we are saying, that you have a module, the generic modules for the AWS component, then you have a module that will set up your environment, and then you have your environmental code that will call this particular module along with passing those environment that is required for dev, UAT, prod. So does that make sense? Okay, great. This I already talked, right? So I said that a typical structure will look something like this, and this is what we have been following. So we are saying that we have a management setup, which will typically have my monitoring servers, my logging servers, my Jenkins server. So then I have a module, which is a pretty standard, and across all clients I can use this, right? Then I have a base, which is typically the VPC setup that I talked about. And then you have your app1 module, and then dev, QA, UAT, prod, and that's how you do it. So any questions till this point of time? Okay, great. This is in continuation to your environment. So when I talked about multiple environment, right? So you have this particular setup, and then you can say that I want to. So this is my client one, this is my client two, right? And that's how you can have it for your n number of clients, because now you have a proper standardization. This is the exact way I want to set it up. If some other clients come up with, say, that three availabilities, and then probably we'll do it differently. But that's how you do it, right? Now I would like you to show something. Now, if you see here, I tried to basically simulate the complete setup, but I was short of time. So that's why what I did, I basically simulated the base infra creation and management management infra creation. Now if you look here, so in Jenkins, there is a concept of multi-branch pipeline, right? So we said that probably our code, Ganesh, as you said that, though it has not that automated check, but at least you have this complete setup so that you can test that whether infrastructure is getting created properly. So you have your dev branch where you will do your development. After that, you will raise a merge request that will get into merge. And then once reviewer will approve, then only it will go into the master, right? Now, one interesting thing that we have done is, what we have done, so a life cycle of Terraform is like get, init, plan, and apply. So what we have done, and again, we wanted to be platform agnostic. So what we did, we used a Docker image of Terraform, which will spin up everything for us. So in any pipeline execution, what we are doing, we are launching a Docker, we are building a Docker image, then doing some initialization, then creating a Docker container that will actually execute our Terraform code. Post that, we are initializing the Terraform plugin, doing plan. Here, there is a manual intervention where you can say that, okay, I would like to execute it. You want to proceed or abort. After that, you create your infra, and then you clean up your container as well. And similar pattern would be required for that management infra. So the thing is that once you have your code properly in place, this is a standard pipeline that can be applied across all your Terraform infrastructure. Any questions, guys?
You have shown configuration management for environments and all that. What about the secrets?
Secret, Ganesh, secret for what?
Secrets like, as same as AWS, if I wanted to use the AWS account.
So see, here we are only creating the infrastructure, right?
Right.
We are not configuring software here.
No, I get it. For infrastructure also to run this?
Yes. So so the thing is that the Jenkins server that we have,
okay,
so there are two ways. So one is, one initially what we did, we started with IAM role, right? So initially we started with AWS keys, then we moved to profile, then we moved to IAM role. Now what we have done in the recent project where we are using Vault, and then Vault basically generates a temporary token which is given to our Jenkins job. And
so Jenkins is the one which is getting. Jenkins is the one which is managing your infrastructure secrets.
Yeah.
Okay.
Any other question, guys?
So, how do you recommend customers to manage the state file? Do you recommend managing a single state file for all the production workloads or multiples?
No. So, what we said that we have separate Terraform execution, right? So, once you have separate Terraform execution for every component, you will have separate Terraform state for each component. So for example, this is a base infra. So you will have its state stored in S3 bucket under a folder called base. Then you have management infra. Its state will be stored in that. So you will have separate state files.
Okay. And have you seen any challenges in case you did a Terraform apply and due to some error, Terraform break? How did you revert back in that case? So there might be case that suppose I applied Terraform apply and Terraform made some changes to the security group, after which it gave an error.
So that's why I said that probably you should have, it's not like that you should directly do it in production, right? You have, first you have smaller, lower level environment, there you test your Terraform code and then you move forward. So at least in production you will not have, and then obviously you have to fix it.
So my question was, have you seen any issues like this?
Yes. We have seen that issues, and that depends on case to case basis, because that error tells you that what is the problem, mistake that you have done, and obviously you have to fix it.
So in your slides you mostly talked about those clients which for which you had to set up the infrastructure from scratch. How do you integrate the Terraform into some client who already has a setup?
I will recommend that you gradually move their code to Terraform. It's not like that you, some people suggest that you should import their infrastructure using Terraform and use that. I never recommend that. I say that probably start it as a scratch, pick one component, convert, set it up using Terraform, and that's how you should move the gradual move. this is my opinion. I have seen some people doing it. They import the complete, using Terraform import, there is an option where you can get the complete state, right? I never liked that approach. I prefer that you create your infrastructure once again using Terraform, but do it step by step. Pick one component, do it. Pick another component, do it.
But what if it doesn't follow your convention? Like
you create your own convention?
But it, you said we like you used to do it for all your clients, but if you know, if
yeah. There is a term called there is no silver bullet, right? And actually, it applies. So the point is that from all your implementation, you will find a pattern. But maybe for some other implementation, you have to find some other pattern. So I'll give you an example. So I talked about two availability zones. Probably some other client will have three availability zones. Some client will say that, okay, for each availability zone, we want to have a NAT gateway. This doesn't fit our convention, right? So probably for those clients, we will create a separate convention. Some people will say that, okay, we want to have VPN tunneling, right? So there we will have another convention. So the point is that you create a pattern out of it from your problem statement. It's not like that. Don't try to fit a solution into your problem. From your problem, find a solution and then try to implement for your problems. Don't do reverse. That will actually cause problem at some point later.